Your time won't supposed to start yet.
Yeah, you're losing valuable minutes.
Okay. Well, everyone, thank you for coming. I've been always interested in the praying mantis since probably kindergarten. We used to always collect the Utheca, which is the egg case, and we'd hatch them in the springtime, and we'd just be amazed at how many babies there are. So recently, in the past 3 years, I've been more into studying the exotic species, and since they're readily available in the hobby, I've been just watching them and studying them. So, here we go. So, the morphology and ecology of mantis. So, what makes mantis different from other insects? Well, they're one of the most highly adapted insects of all. They're very successful. They haven't changed in millions of years. They have over 2,300 species worldwide, contributing over 430 genera. And they have not changed in morphology basically at all. They have not gone through any more evolved states whatsoever. So the most characteristic trait that you see when you look, when you identify mantis is the raptorial arms. These are the front legs, and they have some spikes on the tibia and fibia where they grasp prey with, and they're strictly predatory. No other, they don't eat anything else but insects. So here is another identification feature, is the morphology of the head. Now the head is usually triangular and has two very large compound eyes, and it has three singular eyes called ocelli. There's usually one, two, and three right there. So here is a genus Aragula from Asia. Here is another genus called Rhombidera. And here is another genus from Asia called Theroplacti. So even just in one country, there are so many different morphological features. So they all lay egg cases, eggs inside this thing called the Mantodea, which is basically they secrete this foam protein that they encase inside and on top of their eggs, which protects them from weather, cold, heat, basically everything in the environment that can, even parasitoids, they cannot get through the region. So another feature is that females are almost always larger than the males, sometimes significantly. Like here you see the bottom. This is an adult female Hymenopus carinatus, and that is the orchid mantis, as they're formerly known. And this is the size of the male, and this is incredible sexual animal physique. There's like nothing like that ever. And this is the lower mantis diabolica, which is a species I studied a few years back. I currently do not have them. And this is the female, and this is the male. There's not that much of a size difference, but you can tell in the prothorax that it's a really big difference for the female size. So just to give you a basic idea, here's the phylogeny of Mantodea, taken from the Tree of Life website. And you can just see, here's some genuses just from all around the world, and these are just some of the representatives. And all this is all the genuses that are found. And so there's like Pseudocleobatra, Isiasua, Theocampa, Phylobates, Hymenopus, Adult Mantis, as mentioned before, and some many others that some I don't even know. So, some insects that closely resemble mantids. Now, there's one obvious one that is a clear example of convergent evolution, where an organism that is completely unrelated to another exhibits the similar morphological features. So, the first one that we look at is Mantispinae, which is the mantid fly. Now these are related to lacewings, antlions, dogs, and flies, and they exhibit raptorial arms just like mantids, which is incredibly fascinating. Even the head features are just like mantids. They have the two compound eyes and the three ocelli and the triangular fins. Really interesting. So some people mistaken grasshoppers for mantids sometimes, which I don't even know why. They're very similar. Then lastly, which is the stick insects, and they're reasonably similar to mantids, especially when they're winged. This is a unwinged specimen. This is a northern walking stick female that I found in Castle Craig this past summer. So that's another insect that is commonly mistaken by the public for a mantis. So how has the mantis been so successful? The mantids of the world, specifically in the tropics and neotropics, have just always coexisted there, and their diverse morphological features have gotten them to be so successful as species. So this influences their behavior tremendously in ecology and their representative ecosystem. So here is a mantis that I found in Costa Rica that I currently have not identified 3 years after, and I've extensively looked. And she is a flightless adult female. Here is, you can tell by the abdomen that is a female, and you can see these are not winglets, they're full winged bolt. She's very, very different from most winged plants. Still have not identified them, so I just thought I would put it out there. So, some genus have very similar appearances, and only differences between the two are either the genitalia or the amount of tibial spines on the reptorial arms. And even wing venation, if you want to get that in depth, you can actually look at the different wing venations, and you can actually see that some are very different from others, even though they look exactly the same from just regular point of view. So, the different morphological features that mantids exhibit have an effect on how they behave in their environments. Tremendously. The reason why I study Mantodea is just because they're not understudied, but there's so many species that they're just not studied enough to know a lot about them. So here's the classifications. The two reasons why mantids mimic many things. That's how they have been so successful. They either mimic their surroundings to be unnoticed or sometimes even to be aggressive mimicry, like the example of this Hymenopus ornatus female of attracting prey, which I'll later go into. So here are the leaf mirrors. They're generally dark in color, small in appearance. They're mostly flightless as females. The males are usually fully winged to go to the females that are calling with their pheromone, and they will feign death when touched. Here is an example of a Dermoplactis obotavans, which is just like a decaying oak leaf in the forest around here. So here is Decimata bolivari. This is a species I have kept in culture for almost 2 years now. I'm on the second generation. And they even, that root deca are even camouflaged. They look like seed pods. So here is an adult female. And when you disturb her, she will curl up in your hand and play dead for about 10 minutes. And here's an example. So here's Decimata, and this is a completely different genus from a Panthops. And they look almost exactly the same morphological features, but something with the genitalia and wing venation, wing size, and reptorial tibial spines have created a difference between them. So here are some other species. These are from Southeast Asia. There's Theroplastes truncata, which is one of the largest dead leaf mimics in the world. Then here's Theroplastes obotavans, which is a similar one in the genus. And they both resemble dead leaves. And when you touch them, they either display their wings and underneath the hind wings and fore wings, they're brilliant colors as opposed to the dark brown, gray camouflage colors, or they will feign death and they will disappear in the understory if you don't know where to look and if you're a predator. So here's some of the more impressive ones. These are the Chira dolidus genus, and they were native to Central and South America, and they mimic living leaves as opposed to dead leaves. So here is Chira dolidus stally, and then here's Chira dolidus marbicus. This one is found throughout Central America, this one is found throughout South America. These are the two most commonly encountered species in the tropics that live in leaves. So now we go into the flower mimics. And here's a perfect example of one here that is actually her. So they're normally floral colored, and they are interesting in morphology with petal-shaped wings. Their walking behavior is unique and may even mimic flowers. So here's Hymenopus ornatus, the orchid mimic. So this is what we and other large mammals see as the mantis. And then here's what you can tell. You can see the shapes, they look like petals. And this is basically what an insect sees. It looks exactly like a flower. So it would go to it, and the mantis would prey on this insect. And that is called aggressive mimicry. And this is one of the greatest examples of aggressive mimicry. So here is what they look like when they're just resting. But when during the day, they splay their hind legs against the leaf to create that petal effect. And then insects will actually come to them because they outcompete the flower to do their coloration. And they will show this. So here's Dolomite diabolica, which is the mother. And this one actually mimics, is said to mimic the devil's flower. So how have they been successful? They haven't changed much in a million years. There's fossil evidence as well that they haven't changed as much. At all. It looks just like the present day mantids. So the mantids of the world have adapted to their environments and thriving in ecosystems from deserts to cloud forests, and they will continue to evolve to even more deadly apex predators when they're falling around. So here's the plan for the future of Mantodea. So I just want to keep on studying them and learning about more about them as they're so unknown. Now here's one of the most evolutionarily advanced mantids. It's called the Toxidera mantis. It's not studied whatsoever. And they don't even have a species name for this, they just have a genus. And it actually mimics plant growths. on its full-blown absence.